It is an absolute honor to welcome our next keynote speaker to the stage. She is a theoretical neuroscientist, an artificial intelligence expert who has published research on AI in education, and created Muse, a machine learning-based tool for parents. She was named one of the BBC 100 women in Top 100 Women in 2017, and one of the Financial Times LGBT Leaders and Allies today. Please welcome Dr. Vivienne Ming.
This is a big, cold room. It is awesome being here. I've never been to Grace Hopper in person before. This is awesome. However, I have been here in spirit. Last year, someone tweeted a photo at me, and it was this picture of a wall, and it had all these quotes from Malala and Hillary Clinton, and it was just this amazing wall. And then there was this one quote on there that said, "Ambitious men have been promising us self-driving cars and artificial intelligence and spaceships. If every little girl hadn't been given the reins to her own potential, we'd already have them." And under that, it said, "Dr. Vivienne Ming." I thought, holy crap, that's me. That's so awesome. All these amazing people that win Nobel Prizes, and then some weirdo. I guess it was a good line. Then they asked if I'd come give a keynote. And I said, hell yes. And then they said, could you talk about courage? And I said, wait, what now? I'm a theoretical neuroscientist. I apply machine learning to understand some pretty fundamentally human things. And a lot of it is about courage. But as a research, as a hard numbers scientist, what am I supposed to say about courage? And I thought about my life and friends, the research that I've done. I remembered when I was a full-time academic, before I started my companies, I was at the Redwood Center for Theoretical Neuroscience at UC Berkeley. But even then, I really loved doing collaborative work. So my wife was a professor of education at the School of Education there. And we collaborated. I even had an office right in the middle of this hallway at the School of Education. And there was this young professor there named Randy. And Randy had an office at one end of this hallway, and then a lab way at the other end. And I'd be sitting there working, and three or four times a day, phew, she'd come running past the door. Got a total nut job. Just run down the hallway, run past the offices of all the senior faculty. They're going to vote on her tenure. She didn't care. She'd run down the hallway. Now, education is as important as anything. But there might not be any actual education experiment that requires you to run down the hallway every day. And so I asked her once, why do you do it? Why do you keep running down the hallway? And she said, well, I'm done in my office, and I want to be in my lab. And walking is a waste of time. She was amazing. She knew what she wanted to do. She had a purpose. And later, she asked me to borrow these gloves, you know, the sort of capacitive gloves that allow you to work a touchscreen. She was having trouble staying warm, but she wanted to keep working because that's who she was. And then she started working from home so she could spend more time with her two young daughters and show them what was important to her, because that's who she was. And she got tenure 4 weeks before she died of pancreatic cancer. And she made a sacrifice. She believed in what she was doing so much that she did it knowing she would never benefit, knowing she wouldn't be there to be there with her daughters. She had a purpose. In fact, she had what psychologists would say is the definition of a purpose, something that's bigger than you are, something that takes more than a lifetime to complete. And so she gave everything for it. And I think about my own life in that context. Soon after I decided I wanted to take my work out of the lab and out in the real world, and my wife and I started a company, an educational technology company. No one wanted to fund us. This is before Coursera, before Khan Academy. No one wanted to fund some women. No one wanted to fund education, nothing. And it was pulling teeth. And yet in the middle of this crazy, painful experience where we're wondering how to pay the rent, I get a call from Ericsson, the big corporation. They are collaborating with the UN on this incredible project to reunite orphan refugees with their extended family members. The UN has a book. That book has a million photographs in it. All of these little kids lost. Lost in a system that doesn't know their name and doesn't know the village they came from. And I don't know if I could think of anything worse. So I said, of course I would help. And we built this incredibly horrific game called Sexy Face. You play the game, and we promise, whatever your kink, we'll figure it out, and we'll get you laid. Actually, it was what's called a Trojan. It's a silly little game. You played it, and it trained this artificial intelligence system, this deep learning system, how people perceived faces. Not just whether a face had a certain structure, but what's a face with ennui? What's a face that's happy? And we built this thing, and it worked. We built it so that we could try and reunite families. But oh my goodness, no one would give us any money. My company was dying. And I got scared. And so I pulled out of the project. And several months later, things changed. And I rebuilt the whole system. We trained it up, and it worked. If you're living in Damascus and you haven't heard from your wife's family in Aleppo in weeks and you're fearing the worst and you go to a refugee camp in Jordan, if you use this system and your niece is somewhere to be found, in 3 minutes you found her. I believe in what artificial, thank you. So now you make this part even harder because it was too late. My chance to have helped was gone. Thousands of people possibly could be alive had I been more courageous, had I been willing to say, okay, maybe we'll have to move to a smaller place. I think it is the biggest mistake I've ever made in my life. And if you know anything about my life, that's saying something. I've been homeless. I've had tough times. I have never done anything that I'm either more proud of or wish more that I had brought fully into the world. And so, after that company, I had other companies I was able to build and other approaches to try and help people in the world. And I learned from that. So I founded this lab, and it works very simply. People bring us problems. I don't really care what the problem is as long as it's about people. Dr. Ming, my daughter has 500 seizures a day. Please save her life. Dr. Ming, my son can't enter REM sleep. Please save his life. Our company can't retain women. Help us figure out what's going on. Our country doesn't know what to do about global AI policy and AI for good. Can you help? And if I think that my team can make a unique contribution, I pay for everything. We do all the work for free. And if we come up with any kind of solution, we give it all away. I believe in what I do. It is my purpose. I believe in it so much that I've given myself the coolest job in the entire world. I'm a professional mad scientist. If people come to me, nothing else is helping. And so it's like an episode of House. It's nuts. We take things we know nothing about, and we try to make a difference. And I know that it matters to me, because I have to pay for this job a lot. And I want to spend the rest of my life doing it. We've gotten to build systems to predict bipolar episodes, manic episodes in bipolar sufferers. My son was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, and I hacked all of his diabetes equipment and built the first ever AI to treat diabetes. Turned out I also broke a bunch of federal US laws. We're helping a very large company that happens to be well represented here price the cost of bad promotions, leaving people like you behind when they should have made a different decision. We get to work on all this amazing stuff, and it is the biggest privilege in the world. In one case, we got to look at purpose. Now, purpose doesn't sound like something you'd study with machine learning, but we got to work inside this giant company, 500,000 people. And normally, when a psychologist wants to study purpose, they would give you a survey. So you'd answer these questions about purpose, and they'd look for patterns, and depending on how you responded, they'd either rate you high or low in construct strength of purpose. Something that's bigger than you, take more than a lifetime to complete. Here's what's interesting about those surveys. If you score highly on them, almost everything about your life is better. People that score highly in purpose actually live longer. They have higher walking speed at age 65. They have more friends. They're happier. They earn more money. It's actually a bit of a paradox. It's sort of like telling you that if life was a big race, the people that stop and help the other racers are the ones that win. It doesn't actually make sense. And so I wanted to understand what was going on here. Could we take artificial intelligence and actually observe people inside this company doing their job, living their lives? What is the behavioral correlate of purpose? It's sacrifice. Whenever we saw people take an action for which they would never reap a direct benefit, that meant they were more likely to score highly on this survey, and thereby have this better life. Except that doesn't make any sense. I thought the whole point of life, as economists tell us, is rational self-interest. Don't be a jerk, but do what's in your self-interest. And yet, our research shows us, when we look across millions and millions of people, it's the ones that do it for others that actually have the best lives. What a bizarre finding. And it is wonderful that I get to go around the world and get to work on problems like, how do TV shows affect people's life outcomes? Or can we use artificial intelligence to reach parents and help them raise these amazing kids? And none of these are typical ways people think about AI. I don't build chatbots. I did, when I was younger, work on a facial recognition system for the CIA to do real-time lie detection. That's a little morally gray, I will confess, but it was my very first ever machine learning project, and it was cool as hell. In fact, if you've got an iPhone 10 in your pocket, they bought my undergraduate lab, so all of its face recognition technology was, that's my lab, I worked on that. It was so cool. We got to use that to try and find those refugee kids. I got to build that into a pair of Google Glass to read facial expressions so that autistic kids could learn how in natural interactions with other people. I've had so many amazing opportunities in my life to make a difference. Sometimes it's about my son. Sometimes it's about using artificial intelligence in a way that no one's ever thought of before. Like, what is the tax on being different? We're all different in some way. Some of us, maybe more than others. Is there some way to actually measure that? And we were able to build a system that showed what it means to be different. What does it cost you to be black on Wall Street? What does it cost to be a woman in the tech industry? Not because people are dollars and cents, but because I had a chance to talk to some conservatives about what it meant to be different. And I wanted to use a language that they would understand. It's a tax. the dirtiest word in the conservative language. And we don't have to pay it. So all of this research, all of this work, and now I have to tell you something about courage. And I admit I haven't had the chance to do research on that. But I know I've learned something. I've learned that courage isn't something that you are. Courage is something that you practice. Courage is something that you share with others. It's not something that some smart person on a stage can tell you how to do. In fact, I think I can distill down all of the research that I've ever done, all the algorithms, the millions of people that we've looked at, into this very simple truth. If you want an amazing life, give it to someone else. Thank you.